Good evening, everyone. It gives me immense pride and at the same time a lot of reverence to introduce a living legend of our times, people's doctor, Padma Bhushan Dr. B.M. Hegde. He is an internationally acclaimed physician, cardiologist, medical scientist, educationalist, author of many books, and orator par excellence. He is admired for his humane, holistic, and integrated approach of dealing with people and medical care. Honorable Dr. Hegde has received many awards, honors, fellowships from all over the globe. Dr. Hegde has numerous qualifications to his profile, including MD from King's George Medical College, University of Lucknow, MBBS from Stanley Medical College, Madras University, and various other fellowships that includes FRCP, FACC, FRCGP, MRCP, FAMS from various prestigious medical schools in UK, US, Europe, and India. Dr. Hegde has been a teacher for more than 5 decades. A distinguished personality, he has many credentials that includes currently being editor-in-chief of the Journal of Science of Healing Outcomes, former visiting professor and affiliate professor to many medical schools in US, UK, and India. He was former vice chancellor of Manipal University too. Dr. Hegde has been a deserving recipient of numerous national and international awards, including Padma Bhushan, Dr. B.C. Roy National Award, Dr. J.C. Bose Award for Life Science Research, Pride of India Award from the US, and honorary doctorates. He has served in various trusts and is widely respected for his philanthropic acts. Dr. Hegde doctorates Indian way of integrated healing systems, including breathing techniques, yoga, Ayurveda, clubbed with other healing systems and methods. Please give me a big round of applause for Dr. B.M. Hegde. I now request Dr. Prabodh and Dr. Pradeep to felicitate Honorable Dr. Hegde on behalf of Prabodh Educational Trust with Certificate of Excellence for his distinctive contribution in the field of health and spirituality. Big round of applause. I now request Dr. Hegde to enlighten us with his keynote address on modern life and spirituality. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Hegde.
This naughty girl has been like a leech, would never leave me for the last about a year. Actually, you know, they have been after me for a couple of years now, but unfortunately I couldn't make it. Now I feel so sorry that I didn't come here earlier, because they are doing God's work. Friends, I am totally confused now. Totally confused. I don't know what to tell you and what to talk, because I saw so many good things, so many creative things, so many innovative things, and so many good things happening to mankind, that all my depression about mankind being the enemy of mankind is almost wearing out slowly after seeing all of you. Because I always go around telling people that man's greatest enemy is man today. And it's nice to know there are human beings in this world who really mean paropakarartham idam shariram. You're all varied professionals belonging to several organizations, doing so many good things and doing very well. It's not because you're not doing well that you left that, but you voluntarily left that for the greatest calling on this planet by God on mankind: do something for others. And that is what gives me so much happiness, that words don't come out at all. But let me start off. Prabodh and all his gang, I would call them, of do-gooders. Let me at the outset thank you all for allowing me to come and meet with all of you. Because this, you know, this is such a nice feeling that you forget the whole world worries when you see good people doing good work. And all the brothers and sisters of this wonderful city, Nagpur, where I keep coming now and then. And it's a wonderful place. I like everybody here. Plus, I like the Maharashtrian food that we had this afternoon. It was Sapna selection. We had very nice, what did we have? Kadi, and we had Bakrika. Bagri. Oh, Bakri is goat, is it? No. What is that? Okay. Whatever. But the last thing was very good. Mango. Amarkand. So nice. That was the bonus of coming to Nagpur. Friends, people say he has done this, he has done that. Don't believe them. I now almost feel like echoing what one of those great people of Germany, of yore, von Johanna Goethe, said one day. He said, I now know philosophy, physiology, jurisprudence, and even alas, theology. How much? From end to end with labor keen. But here I stand, O fool, with all my lore, no wiser than before. Friends, man must try to be wiser. When I look at this psychiatrist, I like him. Because most psychiatrists hate me. They would like to see the end of me. Because I am dead against psychotic drugs. Because each one of them derived from either rocket fuel extract or from naphtha extract of Nujol damage the human system. It's not only the psychiatric drugs, other drugs also, because there's a beautiful study done by an American scientist, a great scientist. He is actually a professor of genetics in the Washington State University. Douglas. He's called Douglas. D.C. Douglas. Douglas did a fantastic study. He created a chip called the MIT chip, mitochondrial chip, a computer chip, which tracks the drug when it goes into the human system. And it tells you where, what it does. And he took a lot of our modern medicine, we call it as modern medicine. Why is it called modern medicine? I don't know. Anyway, we call it as modern medicine. And the other herbal drugs, mainly Tibetan, Chinese and Indian herbal drugs. And what came out in that study is something fascinating. The minute we give any drug, when I give any drug, it may be anything from aspirin to statin, the body says, this is something new, I have not seen it. You know, my ancestors have not seen it. Mankind has not seen it. So it must be a poison. That's the wisdom of the human body. So any poison which goes in, the body tries to throw into the chemistry factory in the body called the liver. So it's thrown into the liver. Every drug, mind you, mark my words, every drug. Now what the liver does its best to destroy it. Supposing the liver is not able to immediately destroy the whole lot, something comes out of the liver, which we teach pharmacology students as first pass effect. I used to ask a lot of professors of pharmacology when I go around to medical colleges to lecture, what did you teach about the first pass effect? Very simple. Sir, it is the amount of drug that comes out of the liver after the circulation in the liver. But what is it them about? What is the philosophy behind it? Would you believe not one person ever answered that question? The answer should have been, or the student must have been told, try to prescribe as less drugs as possible, because every single drug, when it becomes a chemical, is not recognized by the human system as its own. This is the beauty. I'll give you an example. There are 43 studies on garlic in the world literature. 43 studies on garlic. And the conclusion is, garlic is good for cooking, but not as a medicine. Now, there was an editorial in the British Medical Journal, and the editor was a good friend of mine, so I told him, I phoned him and said, I'm going to write a letter to you. Richard, you have done one mistake. You have not seen what did they use in garlic studies. What they used was a garlic pill. Now, what is garlic pill vis-a-vis garlic? Anything that we give, we want it to be either nice to the body for taste or, you know, some obnoxious things you don't want. So, West, there are a lot of people who abhor the very smell of garlic. So, to sell drugs, what did they do? They removed the smelling part of garlic, which is called the SH group, the sulfhydryl group, the same chemical that gives good smell for your fart, the same thing. So, they removed that. I'm sorry for using unparliamentary words, but you know, you want to tell the truth, you have to really drive the point home. So, this garlic pill is garlic minus SH group inside a plastic capsule which goes into the gut and there it delivers it. It's supposed to deliver it. By and large, most of the time, the garlic is eaten by our friends in the toilet, whom you see on the television. See, when that, what is that thing called, you spray it, and that they all come like that, and then suddenly you get that spray, and then say, they all die. What's that spray called? I forget it. Harpic Excel. You go back home and see, there are billions and billions, trillions of germs in the toilet. So they are very happy because they get good garlic to eat. What happens to you? Nothing happens to you. Now, garlic, to be effective in the human system, it must be eaten as garlic in nature, and that too in raw form, and that too put in the mouth, chewed, kept there for a minute or two when it burns you, because garlic has a medicine called alanine, but it is in the form of allicine in the garlic, and it mixes with the trypsin in the saliva to become alanine. Unless it that, it's no effect. Now, when we did that study, garlic is a fantastic medicine. From killing germs, viruses, lowering your whatever you call, you know, people have an idea that cholesterol is bad, etc., etc. If you think it is bad, it will lower it. If it is good for you, it will increase it. Actually, now we know that old elderly ladies, you know, old elderly in English means above 85. Old elderly ladies who are still alive and healthy in the French nursing homes have on an average a cholesterol of 500 milligrams per cent to 900 milligrams per cent. Because in your body you have, how many cells do you have in the body? School going kids? 53 trillion. Good. It's not bad. Anyway, 50 to 100 trillion cells. That is 10 to the power 14. And that those cells die in billions every day because they have their time to die. They are told that is called apoptosis. Apoptosis in Greek means falling of a brown leaf. This word was coined by a botanist called Martin Raff, who was a professor of botany in the University College in London in the early part of the last century. And Martin gave the name apoptosis. That is, a cell, when it's told, there's a gene called the suicidal gene. Gene tells the cell, like for example, a red cell, 120 days is life, an RBC. At the end of the 120 days, it gets a message saying that, look, Mr. RBC, your time is up. So the RBC responds, the cell is intact. Apoptosis is intact cell, becomes smaller, 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 and becomes amorphic, loses its structure, form. And at that time, it becomes a speck of dust, and we have a lot of scavengers, and they are so efficient inside, they don't require even that machine to broom. They come, eat it up. Phagocytes. Phage is appetite. They have got so much of appetite for cells, any cell that is dying, they eat it up. So you're fine. But now what happens? You make the surrounding of the cell so bad that the cell, instead of dying apoptosis, dies by necrosis. Necrosis is cell wall breaks. And when this necrosis occurs, the cell content comes out, which is very bad for the outside, and the outside gets destroyed. And this is one of the reasons why you get cancer, etc., etc. So anyway, that's not our content. Now, our content is this, that each cell, when it comes in contact with this kind of a drug, rejects it. So the drug must be taken in its natural form. That is why the poet wrote, little do we see in nature that is ours. Little do we see in nature that is ours. Getting and spending, we seem to have lost our powers. What are we doing? Ask the chartered accountant. How many people want to cheat? I mean, probably, you know, in a philosophic way, today if you cheat the government, I would be very happy because the government is squandering that money. You know, you give that money as tax, it's used for, it directly is into the Swiss banks. And probably India is the biggest depositor in the Swiss bank. So instead of that, you can do some good others. So we have a lot of these what are called philanthropes. The philanthropes are those who really want name for giving that thing. You know, I so and so has given, that kind of a thing. I'll tell you a story of two great people. Bill Gates, whom we all know, oh great man, he does a lot of philanthropy, he gives money, etc., etc. Put just $1 billion for the Gates Foundation. That too because he had a disease for which he didn't get a good psychiatrist like him. He was taking antidepressants. He suddenly had a disease. This fellow likes the tandoori chicken very much. And he suddenly started hating tandoori chicken. Bill Gates could not eat tandoori chicken. And he almost hated tandoori chicken. So he hated food and started losing weight. And all the medical establishment in America, which he created because he owns 3/4 of the drug companies and almost 100% of the vaccine companies. Now, all that couldn't help him. One day somebody told him, look, why don't you give something? You know, that's the essence of Indian philosophy. Tena, tyaktena, bhunjitaha. Isha Upanishad says, I shouldn't be saying that in front of Tripathiji. Tripathi, he has the three Vedas he has found. Huh? So, what does it say? Tena, tyaktena, bhunjitaha, rejoice in giving. So, he was told to give. So, what did he do? He thought for a long time. Kitna dena? 1 billion. 1 billion. For Bill Gates, why? And 1 billion is like for me, 1 rupee. So, he gave 1 rupee. And he made a big fuss about it, doing charity. What charity? He gives you money, but it comes back to his company. So after some years, there was a study done on Bill Gates' charity, which is published in the Lancet, a medical journal, which says what horrible man he is. If he gives 1 rupee, he gets back 10 rupees for his company. This man, see, there are people, there was another rich man who could buy Bill Gates. He didn't know that. His name is Warren Buffett. Buffett he's a chairman of 43 companies, but he doesn't have a single company meeting. When he selects a CEO for the company, he thinks for 1 month. Once he selects the CEO, the next he sees him or contacts him after 1 year with a letter. He says, dear so-and-so, see that you don't lose money for your shareholders. 2, if possible, improve that. 4, do your duty. Warren, that's all. He has not met any one of his CEOs. And he is the richest man. He was till very recently. Now Bill Gates has become richer. Howard Hughes is also like that. No, Bill Gates. So Warren Buffett one day calls Bill Gates for an appointment. His secretary says, no, he's so busy. Next 6 months you can't see him. He says, I just want 2 minutes. Just want to see his face. He says, no, it's not possible. He's so busy. Then he says, can I talk to him? She says, no, you can't talk to him. So the old man one day goes to his house. Office, straight away goes to his office and walks into the office. And he says, somebody, he didn't know who he was. And he said, I just want 1 minute of your time, he said. Okay, Bill Gates was upset, but he said, okay, sit down. He said, I don't want to even sit down. I've just got a check. You are supposed to be doing a lot of charity. I want to give something to your charity, but don't put my name. Bill Gates gave 1 billion. This fellow gave a check for 37 billion. Bill Gates was almost about to collapse. Then he stood up and made him sit down, talked to him for 5 hours. Then he told him, don't put my name, don't do anything. You just do some good things to society. That's the difference between a true philanthrope and a man who behaves like a philanthrope. So that is how society runs. Now come back to our drugs. What happens? Once you take any drug in its natural form, the body immediately says, this is mine, I know. My grandfather has eaten it. You know, it's like rice or it's like wheat. So it is immediately taken in. So the MIT study or the mitochondrial chip study showed that it is the body's intelligence and the energy that runs the system and not the drugs. And all that the modern drugs could do is ADR, adverse drug reactions. The biggest killer of mankind today is not a gun. It's not a plane falling down. You would be surprised, in America alone, whose population is little over the population of probably Nagpur, not Nagpur, 300 million, around less than 300 million, four jumbo jets full of people die every week due to drugs. If one jumbo jet falls down in this world, there'll be news for 2 months in all the television, 24/7. And every week, four jumbo jets fall down. And these people unnecessarily die by what is called iatrogenesis, doctor-induced illness, through our biggest weapons of mass destruction, about which I have written with the caption called Weapons of Mass Destruction in the British Medical Journal, the drugs, chemical drugs. So friends, avoid as many chemical drugs as is possible. I had a colleague of mine, professor of psychology. Some of you might may have been, his name is K.B. Kumar, Professor Kumar, who was at one time the president of the Behavioral Society. He is now in Hyderabad. This boy was so good, I tell you, I took him as the professor. And within about 2 years, the psychiatry department was empty. No patient was going to the psychiatry department. This fellow had to sit till about 1 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the morning to finish his patient load. So the psychiatrist started complaining about him, writing memos about him. He is very bad, he is grabbing our patients. I said, nobody can grab a patient. If a patient wants to go somewhere, he goes. How can you say? So somehow or other, they managed to keep him till I was there. The day I retired, they somehow maneuvered and threw him out. Can you believe that? The best doctor was thrown out. Anyway, he got a better job. And he's now the, you know, he's almost the king of whatever he surveys. And still the same humble soul. And that's why I like this psychiatrist. Psychiatrists have become real drug dispensing machines. Just because they have no patience. The minute he says, you know, I had no sleep last 2 nights, then he says, are you feeling fine? No, doctor, no enthusiasm. Right, he'll start with an antidepressant. And when will that end? Grave. This is the problem. This is the problem. So this is where a psychiatrist, a professor of psychiatry in America, she was young, energetic, and was like our friend. She wrote a book called Dementia, a Drug-Induced Crime on Mankind by Doctors. And she published this book. Her name is Grace Elizabeth Jackson. She was thrown out of the medical college. She was in the Naval Medical College as the professor of psychiatry. She was thrown out of the Navy. She was thrown out of the medical college, thrown on the road. But this book is getting her millions of dollars, and she's invited all over the world to lecture. And her lecture fees is such that, you know, one lecture she can, 10 months salary comes in one lecture. So this girl is very happy. But what I'm saying is, this is how the world is. 1968, I wrote a small article called Unconventional Wisdom in Medicine. When did I write it? 1968. And my department sat together and said, this is a nut. He must be thrown out. So they proposed that I be dismissed. But anyway, that then dean probably was a nut himself, so he didn't dismiss me. So I survived by the skin of my teeth. This happens. This very much happens in this world. So it is very difficult to fight for a truth. I don't want to call the truth, because Khalil Gibran said, never say the truth. It's a truth. And it become different later on, because truth is not something which is stationary. Truth changes. And a truth, even if you fight for a truth, it is difficult. So I like Prabodh and his gang. I can't be naming each one of you because it takes so much of time. Look at this boy, young boy. I like him. He's very, very good. And very versatile too. Everyone. That girl, oh my God, she was very good, that ophthalmologist. And look at this girl, she's very good. Each one is so good, I tell you. They're so nice. And it has made my day coming here. It's made my day. I was telling Ankit that, you know, all that should not have happened in a hotel room happened to me. It happened. But I was enjoying each one of that. I was enjoying each one of that because I did some research. When I went to this room, there was no faucet in the toilet, so to wash your bottom. I thought this must be the highest, because even in the American 7-star hotels, you don't have a faucet. So you will search for it. But at least they have a paper. You don't know about that? An American came to Madras, and he was very fond of Madras curries. So he took his wife and went to one of the RR restaurants in Chennai. RR restaurants are Andhra restaurants. And there, if X is the spicy level of Madras curry, 3X is the spicy level of Andhra curry. So he ordered for chili chicken. And he was tasting it. His wife said, "My God, I can't touch it, honey. It's so hot." "No, no, it's very good. Give it to me." He had her share also. So he finished the whole lot. Nothing happened. He went and they slept. And next morning, he was in the toilet shouting at his wife, "Honey, now I know why the Indians use water for ablution. If they were to use paper like us, it would catch fire." Anyway, then I didn't know what to do. This hotel was so sophisticated, they didn't have a mug, they didn't have a bucket. And all that they had was a little glass for drinking water. So I tried to fill water in that and spill it. It spills on the side. So I did a research. I ordered for a bottle of mineral water, full bottle of mineral water. Stored it in my heating bowl, that, you know, tea maker. And used this. And I tell you, it's so effective. So it took them about 12 hours to fix up the faucet. Now it's fixed. Then the television was not running, if you wanted to see something. Then I said, "The television doesn't run. I am from a village, so I don't know how to put it." So I called the man. He said, "Yeah, it's very easy. Ammayaga, aya, kuch nahi hua." Then he said, "I'll send the IT man. This morning the IT man come." It was not working. Then ultimately somebody came just now when Ankit was there, and he started my television set. But I again thank God, because I had complete rest. Otherwise I would have been seeing something, you know, unnecessary things in the television, wasting my time. So life is like that. Life is to be taken as it comes. And you must know who you are. This is the most important. Let me tell you, you must know who you are, what your abilities are, and what you are. And never look up, look down. I tell people to be happy you look down. If you look up now, if I look up, say, I have one shirt. And if I look at Prabodh, he has got so many shirts. Since yesterday, the third shirt I am seeing. I am in the same shirt. So now, if I want 3 shirts in 12 hours, I must buy more shirts. Misery for me. Now instead, when I go out, I see that man on the road, he has no shirt at all. I'm so happy. I have a good shirt. I have other shirts at home. I'm so happy. So to be happy, look down and don't look up, because there's a nice saying in our language, gudda ke gudda adda. If you look at one hill, there is a bigger hill, there's a bigger hill, and there's a mountain. And the mountain, there is something else. So never look up, but look down. You're always happy, always happy. Because you are a lot. I saw these things doing rounds in the internet one day. He said, if you have 1,000 rupees in your pocket and 1 lakh of rupees in your bank balance, you are in the top 50-100 people in this world, or something like that. So that makes you so happy. Otherwise you think, you know, who am I compared to this fellow Mukesh Ambani? He is presenting his wife a 437 crores small plane for birthday. Can you believe that? And this has a bathroom, a bedroom, a sitting room, a drawing room, and all kinds of things. And 127 crores, 100-story house, where you can't see. When Nelson Rockefeller had depression in 1952, because he made so much money, pulverized everybody in Texas, and made money from all other oil people, then he had a house, huge car. And then he was depressed. Depressed so much that he was not sleeping at all. Rolling in bed the whole night. No psychiatrist could help him, because he didn't come to Nagpur. So nobody could help him. So ultimately what happened was, one day he didn't sleep a wink. So he went to his lawyer the next day. The lawyer told him, "Why don't you do some charity?" That was in 1952. $500 million was big money. And he gave it as charity, as Rockefeller Foundation. And Rockefeller improved and improved and improved, died at the age of 89. So it is in giving that you get, and that is the philosophy in life. You may say, "Oh, I am not Rockefeller, I am not Ambani, how can I give?" No, can't you give 1 paisa from your 1 rupee? You don't lose nothing. Okay, you can't give that. Can't you give a smile? Because you may need a smile in the evening when you're tired. So give a smile whenever you meet. Sapna said that, when you walk, the beauty of walking is not, some people say, "I have money, I'll have treadmill, like that. There also he has got that computer inside, calculating how many crores are coming and going, and he's running. No use at all. Walking must be, the walking's benefit is not just the leg moving. It's the beauty of the thing. You are being one with nature. And you're a part of nature. You came from nature, going back to nature, you're only a part of nature. And that is the beauty of walking in the morning. In addition to the physical exercise you get anyway. That's what Ayurveda usually says. Samikshakari, work very hard. That's the exercise. If you work very, very hard, that exercise is enough to keep you going. And you will feel very, you know, I'll tell you an experiment you do. A day when you are very tired, go for a walk. Come back, you are so rejuvenated. You have forgotten your tiredness. However tired you are, go for a walk. Maybe in the evening, maybe in the afternoon, maybe any time. And there is no time, as long as the weather is okay, you go for a walk. And a lot of our ladies worry about sun, our best friend in the world, the man who keeps us alive. If the sun takes a strike, 1 week strike, we'll be all dead. Why we? Even the plants will be dead. So it's the sun's electromagnetic energy that keeps you and me going. And sun is the best friend. But the industry has produced a myth with television interest, saying that you will get skin cancer, you will become black, your color will go, and things like that. So you have so many things. Sunscreen, one of the important causes of skin cancer. Then all kinds of chemicals on the face, you know, you make up. You must see these people, American people who look so nice on the television. You see them in the house once, you will think it's some ghost of that person. So bad they look, because the skin completely peels off. You go to Kerala and see those women at night, glowing face, because they put coconut oil and they take bath, never wash the coconut oil. Have you seen a Kerala lady in Kerala at the back? She has got a half moon in her blouse. That is her hair standing there with a lot of coconut oil, making an impression. Show me one Kerala girl who has got a skin disease. Because biggest germ killer in this world is coconut oil. Biggest germ killer. That's why in pickles you put coconut oil, you don't grow fungus in that. And you look at a Tamilian girl. No feet, you must see their feet. So clean. Because they don't get out of the house without turmeric paste on the feet. And many of them, of course, the olden style. These days, of course, people are westernized. They put the turmeric paste on their face. They all look jaundiced if you look at them. They all look yellowish. These are all healthy things that we don't do. And the truth is always suppressed for business. Coconut oil. 1964, I wrote an article. Coconut oil is as good as mother's milk and the best fat, because coconut oil and mother's milk are the only two things that contain sodium monolauric acid, which is the basis of human immune system. I even wrote there, suspecting doctors who have not studied their biochemistry properly will have a child to go and see the infant food, which is only coconut oil can be used for infant food. If you use any other oil, the infant will die, because only two things get digested in the mouth, because infant doesn't have the pancreatic juice, pancreatic lipase, so the fat can be digested only by the salivary lipase, and only two things. Even today, you put coconut oil in the mouth, it gets digested there. You don't have to swallow it. It just gets digested and directly goes as ketones. And that is why in America today, coconut oil is a treatment for Alzheimer's disease with very good results. Coconut oil now is the treatment for heart diseases from Harvard. And Harvard has now admitted that because we demonized coconut oil, millions of people have died all over the world. So truth, it's very difficult, very difficult. I tell you, I have suffered so much that in 1984, I gave a talk on coconut oil for the heart in American College of Cardiology meet, where there were 25,000 cardiologists meet in three cities only, because such large conference halls are not there anywhere. And after the talk, they questioned me for a long time. Somehow or other, I survived. Then I was coming out, there was an old cardiologist. He is no more now. May his soul rest in peace. Elliot Corday is his name. He called me and said, young man, do you have any other work in Boston? I said, no, sir. See, it's now 4 o'clock. It will be dark by about 6 o'clock. And the soya lobby is so powerful here, they may bump you off. You better go. This is called truth. This is the truth. You must see the abusive letters I get. I wrote a book called What Doctors Don't Get to Study in Medical School. It came out. There's a big journal in India called the National Medical Journal, which comes from All India Institute. And they think they're All India Institute, they're all gods, because they have political clout. You know, he starts with All India Institute as an MBBS student and dies in NCD as this retired director or somebody. Till then, they're all in All India Institute. So he wrote 2-page review. The author is a fool. He doesn't know science. He's a bloody fool. And he must be hospitalized. And the book is so bad. The English is horrible. And this and that. And all kinds of rubbish he wrote. Would you believe? Copies were sold in 1 week. So I wrote him a nice letter. Thank you very much for getting all my books sold. Now this book was published in London by a company, English company, on their own. And the British Medical Journal wrote a review which said, this is not a textbook of medicine as claimed by the author, but it's a holy text of medicine written by a prophet. Then all over the world it sold. It is so difficult to tell the truth. So difficult to tell the truth. Because people don't want to accept truth because it is not for business. But I always tell people, see, one day I was called to give an oration in a Santom auditorium for 2,500 people, this is about 20 years ago, on one of those saints, Paramacharya, in Kanchi. He was alive at 106, Chandrasekhar Bharati. When he died, there's a trust which made it, and they wanted me to give an oration. And the topic they gave, the topic was quantum physics and Advaita philosophy. So I gave a speech, 1 hour. I was questioned for 2 hours. Madras audience is very, very intellectual. They all come there ready, prepared. And they gave a standing ovation. I went home. I was a vice chancellor in Manipal. I get a letter. Dear Professor B.M. Hegde, you are an idiot. First sentence, full stop. Shankara is a bigger idiot. Second sentence. Between the two of you, don't try to confuse the world. Next time you come to Chennai and talk about Shankara's philosophy, we will throw rotten eggs on your face. Sign, so and so. I enjoyed the letter. You know, I have so nice letter. So I wrote him, dear Sri so and so, thank you very much for your loving letter and the sentiments expressed therein. You may think I am an idiot, it doesn't matter because I know what I am. So you think I am an idiot, it doesn't matter to me. But don't think Shankara is an idiot because you can't assess him. He's too big for you. Leave him alone next time when you're angry. Only blame me. And do you know what happened? This man's ego got punctured. He came all the way down to Manipal, touched my feet and said, I'm sorry, sir. I didn't understand. He was the secretary of the Madhva Pita in Madras. And they hate each other so much. Then I told him, look, you call yourself a religion. And you're in the same religion. You hate each other. Like the Sunnis and the Shias and, you know, Protestants and the Catholics. Time was when I was a student in England, there's two roads, Victoria Road and Falls Road. There are two roads in Belfast like this. If a child from Victoria Road by mistake goes to Falls Road, it will never come back alive. Because Falls Road is purely Catholic and the Victoria Road is purely Protestant. This is the thing that I said, there were three acharyas. They thought about the same thing and looked at it from three different angles. That's all. And they're all great people. And you and I, ordinary mortals, can't even think what they are. So why do you blame them? This man is my best friend now. And his wife makes such fantastic sambar, I tell you. Vengai sambar. That each time I go to Chennai, I get a free meal there. So even if people are angry with you, you give them love. This is my formula. Return anger with love. You win over the man. Win over the woman or whoever it is. Because love is the best tonic that I've ever found in life. But occasionally between husband and wife, even if you love her, you have to occasionally tell her you love her. Because, you know, otherwise she will forget that you love her. So it's not a bad idea to express people that you love them. You know, I make it a habit. Bad habit though, I'll tell you because I don't keep any secrets. Every night before I sleep, I ring up my three children. Because my wife, God thought he can look after her better. So he's taken her away. Because he thought, no, this ass is going around like a Haridasa all over the place and not looking after his wife. So he took her away one fine morning. She had no illness at all. May her soul rest in peace. But my children, they're all grown up. Children have children. but they still, unless I call them wherever I am and say, honey, I love you, I don't get sleep. And now my children have given me what's called an iPad. I don't know. I am a villager. I don't know anything about it. But that's, you press a button. If you have some Wi-Fi or something like that, I can see their face. So my grandchildren would like to see me every day. I feel so happy. For 2 days, I was in some place where the Wi-Fi was not working. But this hotel is very good for Wi-Fi. I'm not joking. The minute I got into the place and when the faucet was not there, I was thinking that I pressed the button, I saw my granddaughter. She says, Ajay, it's good that you called me. I'm going for my friend's wedding. So it's good you called me. So I said, honey, I love you. And, you know, I miss you. And then that's it. You get good sleep, very good tonic. So be yourself. And go back to your roots. Accept what you are. Because if I'm a monkey, if I know I'm a monkey and I accept I'm a monkey, I have no stress at all. But most of us, if we are monkeys, look at this girl. But most of us, we know we are monkeys, but we want to show to the world we are tigers. Now here is a stress, because every second you have to act like a tiger, act like a tiger. Because if something slips, your monkeyness may be seen by society. So the biggest stress is, you don't know who you are. Try to know who you are. And then, you know, life becomes so easy. Don't keep any secrets inside. Open book. Anybody can write on that book. Open book. And you are so compassionate, so happy. Compassion is thy real meaning. See, we have changed the definition of health now. We, in the sense, we have a group of scientists. We call ourselves the World Academy of Authentic Healing Sciences. We are 15 years old. And I, except me, I'm a villager. The 14 of them are who is who in the world of science. 4 of them are Nobel laureates, and they're very influential people. And we have had a decision to say we must change the definition of health as absence of mental, physical, psychological, spiritual, etc., etc., death. And this is the definition of Alma Alta is a business thing. Because I tell you what, absence of disease. Now for that, we have created a business called checkup. Checkup. You are fine, no? You are fine, but you go to a checkup, you come out as a patient. I'll tell you why. It is very simple. Don't laugh. I'm serious about it. Very serious. Because today, you have a TBS, total body scanner, which scans 500 parameters of your body. Okay. Now a little statistics, even a child knows that what are we doing in medicine for the human body? We say your normal blood pressure. What is normal? What is your normal blood pressure is not what my normal blood pressure. Mahatma Gandhi's blood pressure is 210 by 120 all the time. And Sushila Nair was not getting sleep. Mahatma Gandhi was getting good sleep. And the old man died of a complication of hypertension, brain dead, heart disease and this and that. Unfortunately, God say helped him not to suffer from any one of that. So we must thank God say for that. See, what is happening here is, I have a friend of mine who started NIMHANS as the first founder director. R.V. Verma. R.N. Verma is now 89, you know, 91. This man has been seeing me for the last 45 years saying that his blood pressure is 90 by 40. I told him, why are you worried? Brian Box blood pressure is 60 by 40. And he is the strongest man in the world. So what is the problem? He said, see, with the doctors always tell you something to boost the blood pressure. I said, onnu akanda. Angane vittidi ningal irikkum ipo 92 years he says this man kept me alive for 45 years. I said I didn't keep alive that man. So you will never die, you can't die. So your blood pressure is what is your blood pressure. So what is the textbook's blood pressure? It's called the average, statistical average. You check one, our friend knows, all chartered accountants understand, actuaries understand that. You take 1,000 people, check their blood pressure, and no blood pressure can be checked correctly by a human being because the very physics of blood pressure is wrong. I won't go into that because it will confuse you. Come back to this. Now what has happened is, you check 1,000, plot it on a XY graph. Okay, if correct me if I'm mistaken. Then you have a Gaussian curve called the bell-shaped curve, right? Yes. Then you say mean plus 2 standard deviation. Now that comes to whatever. Now I'll give you an example. What is the normal height of an Indian male? Gaussian curve, 5.4, 2 plus this side, that side. 5.2 plus 5.6, you're normal. Okay? Right? Amitabh Bachchan comes for a checkup. 6.2. Our treatment is cut his legs to make him 5.6. Are wo to hum karte hai na? Sugar ko kya karte hai? Blood pressure ko kya karte hai? Wahi karte hai. Then next day, Jaya Bachchan comes for a checkup. She's 4.6, transplant that leg to her. Day in and day out, we doctors are doing this, trying to correct the statistical average, which we tell the common man as normal. So average becomes a normal, there will be what are called false positives. For every parameter, the false positive is 5%, right, sir? Yes. Now calculate, I'm telling you. When you check 500 parameters, what is the false positive? 2,500. So 100 people go for a checkup, 2,500 patients come out. Isn't that a good business? So there was this professor of medicine in America. Her name is Leon Eisenberg. And this girl was 52 years old and she was a very brilliant professor. And she was worried about what she was teaching. One day she asked the brightest class boy who passed out came to visit. She said, who is a patient? She asked. She was expecting a very esoteric answer. The boy very simply said, a man or a woman who sees a doctor becomes a patient. She had a shock of her life. She said, then when does he become a man or a woman again? The student thought for a while and said, rarely ever, madam, if ever. Full stop. This girl resigned her job as professor of medicine at the age of 52 because she said everything is wrong about medicine. And she sat the MCAT test. MCAT is CET, GET, whatever you have, and got a good grade, joined the medical school, that medical school, a student again. Went through 4 years and came out and said, everything that we teach is wrong. Did you get it? You haven't got it because it's not publicized. That article is suppressed. This is very interesting. The first article which studied diet and heart started in 1954, ended in 1959, spent $110 million of the taxpayers' money in America, and the study said diet has nothing to do with heart disease. But by 1959, the myth of fat has gone so much that we have started getting fat-lowering drugs, cholestramine. Have you seen that drug? You have to take 8 tablespoons of that in the morning. It is like sand. And most patients used to vomit it. And that was the beginning of the cholesterol to the statin today. 25 rupees a tablet you give, take it, it kills you. 10% of people who start statin, their blood sugar starts going up. 10% of statin users become diabetics. So 11 million people take statins in India and 1.1 million diabetics are added every year. Then we proclaim, on the other hand, by the diabetic drug people, he said, India is the capital of diabetes of the world. False. The truth is, India is the best country to have diabetes because Americans are following Indian rice diet for diabetes. South Indian rice diet. Idlis in the morning, brown rice in the afternoon, and brown rice in the evening, and a little fruits here and there, 6 times a day, 8:30, 10:30, 12:30, 3:30, 6:30, 9:30. Small feeds. And don't ever see wheat because wheat contains gluten. Gluten goes directly to the pancreas and maintains your diabetes. If you're a diabetic, wheat maintains your diabetes. Good, you know, because we want diabetes to be maintained. This is called disease mongering. If everybody is not mad, what will this doctor do? He'll have to close his shop. See, this is called taking medicine to the marketplace. What did Hippocrates say? Cure rarely, comma, comfort mostly, semicolon, console always. And what is consoling? What is consoling? Psychotherapy. So, today you people are not MDs and PhDs. You are the topmost doctors in the world. Because you are doing exactly what Socrates said. Not Socrates, our friend, our father, Hippocrates said. But we are all hypocrites. He was Hippocrates. And we took an oath in his name and immediately became hypocrites. Today medicine is the biggest industry in the world. Cholesterol lowering alone is $1.72 trillion business. One company which sells cholesterol drugs gets on average $15 to $18 billion profit. A cardiac stent, which is like your spring of the ballpoint pen, costs $10 to manufacture. Sold for $2,000. And the budget is $500 doctor's hospitality. And a company gets a small profit of $1,490 per stent. And of course, you don't get it for $2,000. The hospital will have add so many things, that salt, then in the seasoning, etc. It becomes about 3-4 lakhs. Now what does it do at the end of the day? Nothing. Because the blocks you see are not disease at all. The disease that kills you is not seen in the angiogram. It's called vulnerable plaque, which can't be seen. These blocks are very good because even a child has a block. They did angiogram for young children in the American army, aged between 18 and 22, died in the Vietnam War and the Korean War. They had 4 vessel blocks, 3 vessel blocks. They were very healthy because God has given enough. That's called remodeling the heart. It's preconditioning it. These people with the block get a heart attack, they won't die. But if one gets a heart attack without a block, he will drop down dead. So, but we frighten that. We tell them, don't you know the sentence we use? You're sitting on a volcano. It might burst any minute. So the fellow says, can he go home and come back? He has talked to his wife. I don't know. On your way back home also you may die, so you better do it now. Do you know why? If the bakra goes out and talks to somebody, he may not come back. Now a chartered accountant will tell you, a cost of a cardiac catheter lab and surgery will be about 30 to 40 crores today. They don't put their money. They put some black money as this thing and then borrow it from the bank. There are obliging bankers who give you money. Now, having got the money, now calculate the interest. Calculate the other thing. So you require minimum 4 bakras a day to run the show. That is why Mark Twain wrote, I quote, "For a man with a hammer in the hand and wanting to use it, everything here looks like a nail needing hammering." Absolutely true. That is why we have become a menace to society. It has to change. It can't change otherwise. It has to change from within. And that change can come only if we can bring up a generation, future generation, which is not as greedy as we are. It's a human greed that kills another human being. And if you don't have greed, and if you don't have, as somebody rightly said, I think Sapan said, you have to ego, your ego, you have to sell it, is it? That's why the first thing I sold was, before I sold anything else, my ego in the market. So people say, oh, we must come to take you. I said, why do you come to take me? Do I get any special thing? And they say, we'll get the car. I said, look, you bring a car from 100 miles to pick me up. Then you take me to your place. Then you have to drop me back. That means 4 trips a day. Sir, that is our own car. Car is yours, but where is the oil from? You have to pay for it, no? Now, what do I get if you come or if you don't come? I will take a taxi from here. My taxi company fellow is there. I'll come to your place, pay his taxi fare, and then I'll come back. So it saves at least 2 trips. They don't understand. People don't like it, sir. Chief guest, we have to bring him and all. I said, my driver brings me better than you. You know, I know him because I've been using that car for donkey's years and he is very safe. I can even sleep in that car. You don't bring a big car with a driver who is not known. I can't, every minute I have to be awake. People don't understand that. Because people want to be big, you know. People call me, you know, our naughty girl Poonam was calling me a VIP. I said, I am not a VIP, I am a VVIP, very, very insignificant person. But if you look at yourself, look at yourself. You are a colony of 100 trillion human beings. They are called human cells. And they are all you. And each cell has been living on its own. It has got its mind, it can eat, it can sleep, it can excrete, it can do everything. But for economic reasons, after these chartered accountants came, they said, no, why everybody do everything, we'll come together. So about 100 trillion of them joined together and made a colony called the human body. And you think your human body is solid? There's nothing solid about you. You are like the television screen. You know, I'm talking here. It's like Amitabh Bachchan talking on the television or Hema Malini dancing. You put the television on, Hema Malini starts dancing. You put it off, Hema Malini is dead. But you go to the dining room and put it on, Hema Malini is born there. That's what exactly happens to the human cell. This was found out by a cell biologist called Bruce Lipton. Bruce Lipton. There's a beautiful book you must read called Biology of Belief. This is a fascinating book. This man was an atheist. He never believed in God. And he was a professor of anatomy in the Wisconsin Medical School. And he was a cell biologist. And he was studying not the dead cells like most anatomists study, which he calls as a tombstone of a cell. He was studying a live cell. And he was studying this live cell. And then he saw the cell is live, moves about, does everything. It excretes, it thinks, it can. You just put a drop of poison at one end of the petri dish, the cell runs away from the poison. You put a drop of some good food there, the cell runs into the food and eats it. Then he saw, on the day you are made, you are the one cell, you are called zygote, your weight is 0.1201 gram. But that one cell, when suddenly gets a connection, that's what's called the integral membrane protein with an antenna, like your television antenna, it gets a connection from universal consciousness. And the cell becomes live and it just starts doing everything. This man was looking at it. My God, he said, I thought science runs this world, but look at it, something beyond science runs this world. And he became a believer and he wrote this book and now goes around preaching. Like our friend Sapna, who left her ophthalmology and went around preaching, Bruce now goes around preaching like a preacher, people to have belief in God because it's God who runs the world. That's what's called the biology of belief. Somebody was talking about emotions, the two people, our chartered accountant and our psychiatrist. Emotions have been proved to be chemicals. There is this girl called Candace Pert, a brilliant PhD student, who came to the palace America's NIH is called the palace, where all kings sit. Like, you know, here ICMR is a palace. And like that, they're all big people. I call them Sarkari scientists. And there are Sarkari intellectuals here who give opinion on everything under the sun, from sun to the moon. Everything they give. So this Sarkari scientist, the head of us, what's called Saul Snyder. Snyder is a big name, a Lasker Award winner and a big name. So this girl started her postdoc with Snyder, who had some money for finding out opiate receptors, which are known to be only in the brain, because we thought the brain, mind is only in the brain at that time. So he told her, find out if the opiate receptors are elsewhere. This girl took to it like fish taking to water. She worked very hard, day and night. But by the time the money was spent, there was nothing left. And still she has not got the receptor. So Saul called her, I don't want to waste my money on you. This receptor is over, you go and do something. I don't want you as a postdoc. But this girl said, I'm going to find it one day. Something inside her saying, I'm going to find it one day. So she told him, I don't want money, sir, but I'll continue in this lab. He said, for a change, okay, continue in the lab. 6 months later, she found out an opiate receptor in the muscle. Opiate receptor in the blood vessel. And she was so excited. And she had worked so hard, she deserved a holiday. She locked her laboratory and went away for a long holiday. Then something sensed in this fellow, something is amiss. So he called the laboratory technicians and said, what was this girl doing at night? They said, sir, she was working on the same thing and she has found something. Is it? Then lock was removed at night. And he got the ledger and got all her data. And before she came back from the holiday, he published the data in a paper. And he was so influential that he went to Swiss Academy and said, this is the thing I have found. And they said, okay, you will get the Nobel Prize. So Nobel Prize was declared in his name, but it was not given because the date had not come. When this girl Candace came back, she was so fuming because he said, this fellow who destroyed my career now wants to steal my data. Very bold girl. So she went directly to Geneva and Zurich and then talked to all the members and said, this is my work. This is my original data. This fellow has photostated it. This is not his journal. And of course, Saul did not get his Nobel Prize. Candace lost her job. Candace lost her standing in community, thrown out. Candace wrote a book, Molecules of Emotion. Beautiful book. Molecules of Emotion. Please get that book and read it. Candace Pert, CANDACEPERT is her name. And read that book. And there's a beautiful sentence I'll tell you. Time will come when you get a headache, you don't look for a pill. Instead, sit in one place and elevate your consciousness to the level where your own brain produces enough opioids to kill your pain. Full stop. What a beautiful thing. And that is the future of medicine, my dear friends. But we have to take it out, de-link it from money. Unless you de-link medicine from money, this medicine will kill mankind. I don't know how many of you have read this beautiful article. If you have not, read it in the Google free. It's called Death by Medicine. There are 5 authors. The first author's name is Gary Null, GARYNULL. Please read that. You will get a shock of your life that we are the leaders of death in the world, followed by cancer low down and heart attack much lower down. On the top of the list, in a country where we think there are so much checks and balances, if it could happen, you horrified, you take the audit in India, my God, you will be shocked. That is why we went to the IOM, convinced them that the future of health definition should not have absence of disease, because there is nobody who has no disease. If I now scan all of you with the TBS, all of us will have not one cancer, 10 to 15 cancers. But they don't become cancers, they all die. When do they die? When you have a good mind and when you want to help someone, cancer cannot grow in you. But when you eat a lot, like a pig, and hate everyone, cancers grow like a tree. And that's what happens. And it's in the mind. Everything is in the mind. And where is the mind? Never mind. And the mind is everywhere. It's in my hand. And who is the mind? For every 9 cells of germs in my body, I have 1 cell of mind. In your body, for every single cell of yours, you have 9 germ cells. In your own genome, we are saying we are human genome, we know everything, we are doing genetic engineering, we'll do stem cell. We don't even know 1 by 1 a millionth of a genome, because genome contains 23,000 human genes. and 2.5 trillion germ genes. Germinomes, metabolomes, virinomes, all of them put together, the metagenome is all germs, and I have written an article, you read that, it's a simple article called Germs Are Us. Toys Are Us, you have seen, you know. So I wrote Germs Are Us. We are germs. So when I say, did your father have diabetes? Yes, sir. Oh. Then you become a diabetic. With fear itself, the sugar will go up. Your father's diabetes has nothing to do with you. Because your father and you, the relationship is one in a million zeros, one. But you may be a diabetic if the germs is a diabetic. So you are a germs child. And these germs are our friends. We have come one full circle from Pasteur. Louis Pasteur said, germs kill. And then they say, germ theory was born. And that's why mankind is alive. It was a great day for medicine. And antibiotics were Today it's a very sad day for medicine because there are 500 antibiotic molecules. They cannot even touch some of the germs which have grown in the hospital called superbugs. And do you know how we kill it? When Murarji Desai used to drink his own urine, we used to laugh at him. Didn't you laugh? You also must have laughed. Because most of us are RNIs. You know RNI? Resident non-Indians. Most of us live here, think with American mind. Now, America, do you know what they are doing? Because patients are dying like flies in the intensive care unit with nosocomial infections. One Professor Chu in Johns Hopkins Hospital, she went into veterinary science. In the veterinary science for hundreds of years, infections were treated not by the present vets who use antibiotics. In the olden days, vets, cow's infection was used by cow dung. This girl did a bold thing. The patient was dying of a simple Clostridium difficile infection. And otherwise the patient was very healthy. So she gave the shit of her patient's own mother, 250 cc shit, emulsified, put it in a tube and put it in the mouth. By evening the patient became all right. Now for severe infection, the treatment is, in American jargon, fecal transplant. Fecal transplant. Morarji Desai was drinking urine. Today it's fecal transplant. Now America says human urine has so much of calicrinins and so much of immune boosters that it could be treatment. And cow's urine is now patented for treatment as an immune booster. One day I was with the central minister. This fellow was used to be my patient. So he one day told me, Professor Hegde, shall I tell you a secret? I said, go ahead. You can tell it to the world. I don't care, he said. I said, okay. He was admitted with what is called ulcerative colitis. You must have heard about it. Which means we don't know anything about it. It's called idiopathic disease. We are very happy about this disease. Idiopathic means I am an idiot. But that idiopathic is in Latin and I am an idiot in simple English. I am an idiot, I don't know. And he was having 20 loose motions of blood every day and lost about 20 kilograms. And he was admitted in intensive care unit in the All India Institute. One day Morarji Desai, his prime minister, came to see him. He told him, you bloody fool, on the first day itself I told you to drink your urine, you forgot. Now anyway you are dying, drink your urine, he said. And he says the next morning he drank because he wanted to survive. One day drinking, 20 became 18. 2 days drinking, cut short, 10 days drinking, he went home. And he is alive now because somebody has now removed a part of his brain intentional to make him a vegetable, but he is still alive. He is about 76, 77, 78. I have another chief minister friend of mine. One day he told me, Professor Hegde, do you know your friend? So and so, yes. He was our party chief. And I had an eczema. My father was a doctor. I'm an engineer. But this eczema will not go. I was looking so ugly, I couldn't face the world. One day, your friend, that minister, told me, hey, drink your urine. I tell you, I faithfully do that even today. I have no disease at all. I'm so fine. Both these ministers were saying, we'll give you money, you do a research. But I have done my research already because I have a lot of volunteers, don't worry. And we have shown how important it is. I had a patient recently who had a heart attack and he came to me. He survived somehow or other. Not because of me, they all survived because of themselves. Now this man had ulcerative colitis. So his gastroenterologist gave him sulfapyrazine. And next day he had Stevens-Johnson syndrome. He was almost dying, kidney failure, whole body was bloated with skin and heart failure came and he became really bad. So his wife was crying. Doctor, heart attack, you saved him, but with this simple diarrhea, he is dying. So I told her, look, if he is dying, definitely ask him to drink his urine. He became all right in a week's time. The whole thing stopped. So we have, little do we see nature that is ours. because the world is too much with us, money is too much with us. This is what our friend Wordsworth, William Wordsworth, wrote after the Industrial Revolution. The world is too much with us, late and soon. Getting and spending, we seem to have lost our powers. Little do we see in nature that is ours. We have sold our soul, a sordid boon. Friends, don't sell your soul to the devil. Who is the soul? Now we know where the soul is. Here is this quantum physicist who is an astrophysicist. His name is Robert Lanza. And Lanza has found that the soul leaving the body. How many of you have read that beautiful book called H.W. Wells written a book called Holes in the Wall? If you have not read, read it. H.W. Wells, the fascinating book called Holes in the Wall. Or a book called Bridge on San Luis Rey. Bridge on San Luis Rey. It's a 1927 Penguin classic written by a man called Thornton Wilder, an American writer, and in which he says how there are two worlds, the world of the living and the world of the dead, connected by a bridge of human love. Now, multiverse is a theory of Lanza, multi-universes, and our Sanatana Dharma, especially the Upanishads, talk about multiple universes, and so beautifully. And what the Upanishads talk is quantum physics. Asino Vrajati Duram Shayano Jati Sarvatah is what an electron is. Nobody has described the electron as well as Upanishads. That is why I tell people, see, ultimately, Indian philosophy is the greatest philosophy. Indian philosophy doesn't mean Hindu philosophy. There is nothing called Hindu religion. It's Sanatana Dharma, ageless religion. And all people can, a Muslim can have Sanatana Dharma, a Christian can have Sanatana Dharma, because Sanatana Dharma does not belong to any God, because Vedas don't proclaim God at all. If you see Om Bhur Bhuha Swaha Suryaya Namaha, Surya is a Shakti. Om Bhur Bhuha Swaha Agniya Namaha. Om Bhur Bhuha Swaha Vayave Namaha. What is Vayu? Vayu is the lightning. Why do I do that? Prajapate Namaha. Ultimately, I am doing it because I can't see that Shakti called God, so I am propitiating what He has created. What is wrong in it? That's the beauty of it. And that is what is important at the end of the day. And whether it's you're a doctor or anybody, you have the old Indian Sanatana Dharma which says, do you know what it says? It's all condensed in the Mahabharata. The Mahabharata is an epic, India's epic, which is unrivaled by anything. Odyssey, Homer, this, that, nothing. And in Mahabharata, Rajagopalachari writes a beautiful commentary on the Mahabharata. Rajagopalachari writes, I wrote, what is not in it is nowhere. See, what is not in it is nowhere. One sentence, that's all. That means Mahabharata has everything. It has passion, it has jealousy, it has hatred. It's, you know, after all, what is Mahabharata? What is Odyssey? What is Iliad? All for a woman, you fight a war. But look at the Indian culture. That girl runs away with the enemy in Iliad, Homer's. But here, Sita comes back to her husband, Parvati comes back to her husband. That's the difference. So somebody said, a friend of mine used to say, doctor, why read whole of Mahabharata? Just read two sentences, two words. What are they? Dharma Kshetre, Kuru Kshetre. Now, cut it. Dharma plus Kshetra, Kuru plus Kshetra. Rewrite it. Kshetre, Kshetre, Dharmam Kuru. In every walk of life, do your Dharma. Dharma is not religion. Dharma is your obligation to society. And if you did that, you will all be healthy. Poonam said, it's time up. Okay? Katam, she says. Do you know, when Thomas Jefferson became the president of the United States of America, he was known for long-winded speeches. His uncle called him and Thomas, you have become the president now. Take note. Stand up, speak up, and shut up. So I stood up, I thought I spoke up, and now I shall shut up. Because one of the people who talked here, I don't know who, said, while sound is good, silence is golden. It's in silence. You see, when you say Om, Om. It is that silence which probably reaches the other end. And you really get happiness at that stage. So I don't think I should go on and on. And I know what you will all say when you go home. Why did Prabodh call this idiot? You know? Because, you know, there was a parish priest, a friend of mine, who was going from place to place lecturing. One day he was to lecture in Nagpur. And he was staying in a hotel. Not this hotel, because there's no faucet. That being a Sunday and there was no television, etc., he wrote a nice letter to his wife because he had left home and going around the world. and he wanted to post it. He came out, being a Sunday, he didn't know where the post office is. So there are urchins playing. He told them, they didn't understand their language. So he said, can you take me to the post office? They said, come along, it's a holiday for us, we'll take you to the post office. They took him to the post office, he posted the letter, he was coming back. Then being a priest, he said, my God, these children have done something for me. I'm a spiritual human being, so I must do something in return. So he said, I'll buy some chocolates for them. Went to the shop and said, come on, give chocolates. The man gave chocolates, he put his hand in, the wallet was in the Ashok Hotel. So he said, my God, what can I do? So he told the children, sorry children, I forgot my wallet. But in this evening's lecture, it was arranged by Prabodh Charitable Trust, but it's not charity. This lecture of mine is money. You have to pay 100 rupees per lecture. Yes. I will give a note to Prabodh or Poonam. You take it and they will let you in free. So for showing me the post office, you have 2 free tickets. Children laughed. He said, why? Sir, there are a lot of fellows like B.M. Hegde speaking, but listening is very difficult, sir. Who wants to listen? We have better things to do in the evening on a Sunday. But he said, no, I am talking on a very important thing because I am a priest, I am talking about spirituality, I am talking about God, I am talking about way to heaven. And he became emotional. Children burst out laughing. He said, why? Sir, a man who doesn't know the way to the post office, how could there no way to heaven? So my dear friends, spirituality is nothing very esoteric. We are all spirits, not spirits, but spirit. Spirits is what is available in the shop. Spirit comes from the word spirus in Latin, which is breath. So our ancestors, cave dwellers, knew one thing. An animal which they killed for eating did not breathe. A live animal breathed. So they hypothesized, just as we do in hypothesis, breath is a god who enters you and leaves you when you die. Which of course is not true, but then that is how the word spirituality was developed from that. Spirituality has nothing to do with religion. Absolutely nothing to do with religion. Spirituality simply is dealing with the spirit. That's a human being. And how do you deal with the human being? Because why do you deal with another human being? Because he is a part of you. Today, the greatest quantum physicist Max Planck says, consciousness is fundamental. Everything else is derived from that. So you are derived from the consciousness. I am derived from the consciousness. From the same consciousness. Supposing I want to hurt our chartered accountant, it hurts a part of my body. So I want to destroy him, my body gets destroyed by my own cells. That's called autoimmune disease. Me, you concept. Leave that me business, I business. Make it we business. And the day you leave the I and you become a we, you are fine. A shishya went to a guru. He said, sir, I have come here. I want peace. I want peace. He was fighting. And the guru said, say that again. I want peace. He said, okay, say that without the I. Want peace. Want peace. Now without the want, peace. See, there is peace. What is preventing peace? Want and then I. So let us leave I and want and live in this world as we. Thank you very much.
Trust.
Friends, I'm sure you all have gathered here this Sunday afternoon because of an inner urge to experience wisdom that is going to be showered by our exceptional speakers today. Exceptional because unke jaisa koi hai hi nahi. We all are here directly or indirectly because we know one person here who is a pillar of change for human minds. Hum unke bare mein jitna bolna chahenge utna kam hi hoga. And he is none other than Dr. Prabodh. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together once again for Dr. Prabodh.
Sir, if we can have, yes. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Dr. Prabodh. His academic qualifications include MSc in Statistics, MBA in Marketing, LLB, MS in Psychotherapy and Counseling, PhD in Psychotherapy and Counseling, DSc in Psychotherapy and Counseling. The courses attended by Sir are Hypnotherapy, Past Life Regression Therapy, Art of Living, Siddha Healing, Pratiprasav Sadhana, Transcendental Meditation. He is practicing psychotherapist and counseling consultant. Counselor to RBI and advisor and consultant to social and academic institutions. Positions currently held by Sir are founder, president and life member of Association of Counselors and Psychotherapists, Nagpur, Director at Institute of Psychomanagement Studies, Managing Trustee of Prabodh Education Trust. And more than anything else, a friend, philosopher, and guide to all those who associate with him. One thing I have personally learned from Sir, and I would like to put in a few words. Ye raahi hi le jayengi hame manzil tak, hausla rakh ae musafir. Ye raahi hi le jayengi hame manzil tak, hausla rakh ae musafir. Kabhi suna hai ki andheron ne savera hone na diya ho. Requesting Dr. Prabodh to come on stage and share a few words with us.
My very close friend, who became my friend less than 24 hours now, Padma Bhushan, Dr. B.M. Hegde. Because it seems friendship doesn't need amount of years and time to spend together. It happens instantly, which I have been experiencing since yesterday evening. The guests of honor, Mr. Prakash Khemka, Mr. Sudhir Baheti, Mr. Aditya Tripathi, today's expert panel who have contributed their experience and wisdom in the earlier session, advisors for the Prabodh Educational Trust, organizing committee, and a very generic word, all my dear friends. I'm so happy to be here. It is so overwhelming to talk to you on this annual day functions. Because I have so much to say, and it always seems that there is so less time given to me. Because of the paucity of time, perhaps I'll have to restrict myself for 10 minutes, but I must speak my mind on this occasion. So let me really put the words to my feelings. Friends, I really feel nice, so comfortable to be with you, you being the part of Trust family, Prabodh Educational Trust family. And on this occasion, always I look back and then plan to look ahead. Looking back, I remember when I took up something in the educational field after giving up the public sector job. That time my observation was, I need to do something in education because I thought education is corrupting, ruining, disturbing, alienating, hindering the process of growth and evolution. I might sound absurd. I might sound obnoxious, but this is what was my feeling about the educational system, which is prevalent right now. And even today, I see a lot of souls to be saved from the present education system. So my strategy to overcome or contribute in the educational field was to collect the people, collect those people who are different, and collect those people who want to make difference. And friends, I am so proud to say that I have not one, many of them, whom I have collected over those 13 years of time. And after having collected those people, the second strategical aspect of it was to connect them. And this annual day celebration is precisely to see that how closely we are connected. And if I thought I could collect and connect those people who have difference and ability to make difference, perhaps then I can think of correcting the system. And today, to bless us on this occasion of giving insights to correct the system, we have none other than Padma Bhushan Dr. B.M. Hegde. It is such a blessing to have such great souls to be with us. And friends, I share you one thing, which is my personal experience. You are not to talk, you are not to argue, you are not to debate, you are not to discuss. Just being with some souls is so enlightening, so delightful, so much experiential. You learn a lot by their presence. I believe energy transfers so quickly. Something happens. And I think what we are doing is letting the things happen. Doing is like becoming, and letting the things happen is like being. Today, we must not forget the day is auspicious because it is Swami Vivekananda's day. It is his birthday today. And what he has said some 150 years back was, each soul is potentially divine. And somebody like Arvind Kejriwal also would say the same thing, don't underestimate the power of a common man. Oh yes, I think both of them are saying the same thing. The common man, and he has an immense potential, is what is being talked about. And Swamiji said something 150 years back, The same thing. Each soul is potentially divine. And on this occasion, I only believe that we could reinforce this belief that we are divine and we have a tremendous power. Don't misuse, abuse the word common man. Common man is such a big word. And I believe this is the purpose of our coming together. And how did I start this journey? I thought maybe I would concentrate on the next generation. I thought catch them young would be the better strategy. So I started with Prabodh Academy, dealing with the student stress, working on their memory, concentration, and how to write examination. I thought that is a better way of influencing the parents also, though, so they can pay me money and also keep my things moving. And also at the same time, I can make a small difference into the field of correcting the education system. But then I found that telling, advising children was not sufficient, because whatever I tell the children, ultimately those are the buyers who influence the decisions. Consumer consumes and the buyers influence. And those who pay money for the children's education have a bigger say on the children's mind than those who work on with them. I thought maybe I'll have to have an additional strategy to really deal with those other lot who are influencing and buyer in this marketing scenario. So I started spreading the knowledge of counseling and psychotherapy, and to really legalize and legitimize it, I started courses in counseling and psychotherapy. Running an institute is not my field, it is not my cup of tea. But really trying and the desire to work on correcting the system, I thought I'll have to do something, really spread knowledge, talk to the parents, talk to the teachers, see how I can, or we collectively can. By that time I had a lot of friends who were really working with me with the same mission and purpose. So we started this Institute of Psychomanagement Studies. And the courses was just to really lure, because when somebody pays the money for learning, he also needs the evidence that he has learned something. So the diploma and degree is just a paper evidence to say that the person has acquired knowledge. And at times we are more concerned with the evidence of the knowledge than the content of the knowledge and the real knowledge which needs to be carried with. Having started this IPMS, courses started picking up. Then there was an issue of credibility as to which professional body you belong to and what is your credibility and which is a registered thing and all those things like. And then there were a lot of good students who thought we can come together and really make this professional ethical one and a professional one. So we formed a professional body called Association of Counselors and Psychotherapists. I am proud to say that I am a founder president of this association, and Dr. Sapna now is the president of the association. So having connected the professionals together and into serious practice, then there started a lot of professional practitioners in this profession coming and really working full-time for this professional inputs. After few years of experience, I thought there are some more issues which are beyond the academic domain, the educational domain, and still affect us. It is a common man, it is an average man, it is anybody who needs a counseling support. Who needs help, but then it is not in the formal education format. We had our concepts like Aadhaar, Swayam Siddha and Anand Mission, which I was toying with, but which could not pick up. The roots were not very strong. Last year, we had a brainstorming, and we thought maybe we can conglomerate these three organizations and come together with something called a Swayam Shodh. Because purpose of education is to really evolve. Purpose of education is to really take our journey of life ahead for a purpose. And Swayam Shodh is precisely this. And friends, let me share my personal experience and professional experience with you. When I started dealing with the clients through the art they possess and encouraging and helping and enthusing them to really perform on that art format which they are comfortable with, there was a lot of therapeutic effect. And the presentation today on the dais in the first session was precisely the evidence which will validate what I'm saying right now. I have many people who had some issues and who had some talent which they never bothered about expressing. They started overcoming their issues in their personal lives and also in the other areas like professional and other social areas. बहुत अच्छा लगने लगा और स्वयं शोध का जन्म वैसे हुआ है स्वयं शोध के लिए ऐसा व्यक्ति भी मिला जिसने स्वयं शोध को खुद की शोध भी बना दिया है आपने यहां पे जो देखा होगा डॉक्टर चेतन रेवतकर यू आर सीइंग हिज प्रेजेंस सी देयर आर पीपल प्रेजेंट हियर एंड देयर इज अ प्रेजेंस ऑफ वन पर्सन and it is Swayamshodh. When we express ourselves, the what shall I say, जब हम अपने को खुद को प्रकट करते हैं तो ऑटोमेटिक इफेक्ट होता है. यू हैव नॉट टू रियली नाउ यू हैव नॉट टू क्रिएट ए इफेक्ट. ट्राइंग टू क्रिएट इफेक्ट इट्सेल्फ इज काउंटर प्रोडक्टिव टू द कंसेप्ट ऑफ इन्फ्लुएंसिंग. इन्फ्लुएंसिंग इज नॉट अबाउट ट्राइंग टू डू समथिंग. इन्फ्लुएंसिंग इज वॉट हैपन्स वेन यू आर देयर प्रेजेंस एंड यू वुड फाइंड फ्रेंड्स. नाउ द नेक्स्ट सेशन ऑल्सो यू फाइंड दैट द प्रेजेंस वुड बी फेल्ट बाई यू. स्वयंशोध इज एक्सप्लोर यूर सेल्फ. The purpose of education is to master ourselves, not to master the subjects. Unfortunately, our education system has always really focused on mastering the subjects called physics, chemistry, mathematics, biology, whatever. And having mastered the subject to the MSc, PhD, DSc level, we think that we have now become somebody which we could be proud of. And all those people who are proud of their qualifications, I find them very miserable in their personal lives. I find him creating negativities around him. I find him alienating themselves from the rest. How can education do this to us? I don't think this is the right education. Swayamshodh, finding yourself, has to be the purpose of education. And on this occasion, I would say, the Swayamshodh is the strongest arm of Prabodh Educational Trust, and we are going to strengthen it more further. I do not know how I am going to do this, but with your blessings, with support, with your presence, with your wishes, I am sure the things are going to move ahead. I think I should not be exceeding that my time, because there are a lot of things to happen, and I am sure you are all very eager to listen to Dr. Padma Bhushan, B.M. Hegde. Quite a few must have seen him on the YouTube or wherever. He is a revolutionary, and I feel blessed when he has come over here on our small request and making a big difference for us. And friends, when somebody from the outside comes, say that he knows something more or bigger. It is just to say that we are all connected, interdependent, interrelated, interconnected, and all those things. And in his presence, I want to honor a few of our own friends, colleagues, achievers who did something great. On this occasion, it has to be celebration. How do we celebrate? We have to honor, we have to felicitate, we have to create, and then the people whom we create, felicitate and appreciate, should they be from the different group? No. I think
हमारे लोगों का सत्कार हमने खुद करना चाहिए. आज हम अपने लोगों का अपनों के सामने अपनों के हाथ से सत्कार करना चाहते हैं, जिन्होंने समाज में अपने अपने क्षेत्र में कुछ बड़ा काम किया है. यहाँ के गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर तीन जो हैं, उन्होंने अपने अपने क्षेत्रों में बहुत बड़ा योगदान दिया है, कुछ अलग कर रहे हैं. और उन्होंने अलग किया ये तो हम आज एक सिंबलिकली कह रहे हैं. हर व्यक्ति हम में से, हमने जैसे कहा आम आदमी, कॉमन मैन, ईच सोल पोटेंशियल डिवाइन, वैसे इनकी डिविनिटी एक्सप्रेस हो गई, बाकी लोगों की भी एक्सप्रेस हो रही है. अगले साल आने वाले वर्षों में मुझे विश्वास है कि बाकी लोगों का भी हम ऐसे ही कुछ सम्मान होगा, होते रहेगा. वैसे हमारे साथ और एक व्यक्ति है जिन्होंने काउंसलिंग क्षेत्र में बहुत बड़ा कार्य किया है. हमने इस साल समुपदेशक शिरोमणि नाम का एक अवार्ड, एक पारितोषिक, एक साइटेशन हम इस बार प्रनाउंस करने जाने वाले हैं. दैट इज गोइंग टू कम. व्हाट शुड आई से राइट नाउ? आई एम स्पीचलेस. आई डोंट हैव वर्ड्स टू एक्सप्रेस माई ग्रेटिट्यूड, माई थैंक्स, माई ओवरवेल्म्ड हार्ट. आई डोंट नो व्हाट टू स्पीक. Thank you so much, friend. Listening to me. I'm sure I am today very not very coherent, but still, when you are emotional, you need not be coherent. You need not be logical. I am not that rational, I know. But then emotionality binds us. I know you all love me. I love you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Prabodh. I would like